Okay, I think we are ready. The colloquium chair is busy today, so I have the honor to introduce our speaker, Professor Howard Milchberg. So he received his undergraduate degree in engineering physics from McMaster University. He held a National Science and Engineering Research Council of Canada fellowship at Princeton University, where he completed his PhD in astrophysical sciences in 1980-something. He told me not to to say the date. But
wait,
you don't know
say the late 80s, not the early 80s.
His dissertation was on one of the first two soft X-ray laser experimentally demonstrated. So, and Professor Milchberg enjoyed band labs as a postdoc. So that was a very good place and a lot of good people, including our dean came from, I think. So where he performed among the first experiments in high-intensity femtosecond laser plasma interactions. And in 1988, so sorry, I told the date, Milchberg joined the University of Maryland, where he received a NSF Presidential Young Investigator Award. He is a professor in the Department of Physics and Electrical and Computer Engineering. Professor Milchberg is a distinguished scholar, teacher at Maryland, and a recipient of Senior Faculty Outstanding Research Award from the Clark School of Engineering. He is a fellow of the APS and the OSA. In 2005, he was awarded the APS Division of Plasma Physics Award for Excellence in Plasma Physics Research. Three of his graduate students, most recently in 2012, have won the APS DPP Marshall Award for their dissertation research. So he's here to talk to us about spatio-temporal optical vortices. Please join me to welcome him.
Okay. Thank you for the kind introduction. I'm happy to be here. The most important part of that introduction is that I'm from Canada, and I have a clipboard where you can write your name on the clipboard, and I can write a note, a letter of recommendation for any of you who want to move up to Canada. Anyway.
We invited you here.
So. Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about something that sort of a new thing in our lab that came out of the few years we've been studying optical filaments, and I'll show you how all of that happens. The main guy on this is my student Nihal Judge, who's a senior graduate student now, and I'm the advisor, so you can apply the appropriate weighting factor to me, and that was a joke line, and then we have other students involved. Jared is a research scientist. Some of the results I talk about here are going to use simulations. So we have a wave propagation simulation code, very similar to what Jerry, not exactly similar, but in the same vein as what Jerry and Miro use here. And then we do wave propagation in a more intense regime, which requires complex computations, and I'll talk about that. The lab is filled with equipment, students from different projects all coming together to collaborate on this, so that's why I have all these agencies listed here. And I need to advance the slide, and it ain't advancing. Hold on. Why is it not advancing? Okay, hold on. I don't know. There we go. Hold on. I got rid of that bar. Maybe this will do it. Nope. Nope. There we go. There you go. Okay. So I'm going to start with the punchline here. And that's that when you send an intense laser beam and it self-focuses and collapses, and I'll tell you all this, what this means to self-focus and collapse. But what happens after that event is that what we like to think of as an electromagnetic smoke ring accompanies the pulse. Okay, and again, a smoke ring is a phrase that we dreamt up so that the university press release about our work would be more digestible by people who read it. But what it really is a sort of a vortex structure in the optical phase, and it has angular momentum and topological charge associated with it, and I'll show you how that works. And the two systems I'm going to talk about that for when this happens is filamentation of femtosecond pulses in air, and this is what I was referring to. When I started, this is something we've been doing for a few years, and I'm going to talk about experiments and simulations. But another area of my lab, which was somewhat independent until we got into this vortex business, was using lasers to accelerate particles to relativistic, charge particles to relativistic speeds. And that also relies on filamentation, but it's a relativistic nonlinearity, not a nonlinearity that you get in an atom or a molecule. And I'll talk about that. What I'm going to talk about primarily here is simulations, but we are starting experiments in this. And I originally, when I had this slide prepared, I had this experiments thing in less bold font because I didn't want to scare my students too much because they didn't know about at the time when I showed this slide for the first time that we'd be doing experiments in this. So this is the picture of what this looks like, and this you can think of as a time sequence of pulses. So what it is, there's this the red area here is a short optical pulse, and there's a section in the middle where the intensity is a little lower. Now, this shows the intensity completely eaten out. It's not really like that. The intensity actually drops off so that the center of the toroid has got a null. There's a null intensity there. And then the electromagnetic phase circulates around this thing. So the whole thing you can think of as containing angular momentum, but the sum of the angular momentum all the way around this thing, the integral is zero. But there is angular momentum density inside the structure. And this thing has topological charge, and it is a very robust object, as we'll show later. So now, how is this different from vortices that are already well-studied in optics? So typical Laguerre-Gaussian beam has a hole in the center. Okay, there are various kinds of them, but they all amount to a phase circulation going around the outside of the beam. So this is the propagation direction. So the phase circulates around the K vector, right? So a typical hole may have a first order phase singularity would have a phase of pi, 2 pi going around the outside. So that's well known. And there's angular momentum associated with this phase gradient. A line spatio-temporal optical vortex would look like this. Okay, we haven't made this yet, but this is sort of the simplest version you might conceive of. So this is a pulse moving in the direction of the arrows. This is not a very good picture of a pulse. It was just easy to rotate this thing. It's not a wheel. You can think of it as a teardrop with a line going through the center of it. So now you see the angular momentum or the phase gradient is around this line, and it's moving in the frame of the pulse. It's moving with the pulse, whereas in this case, you can think of this as being stationary in space. You only need space coordinates to describe this phase circulation. In this situation, you need space-time coordinates to describe the phase circulation. And so again, I show you here what we have. So there's a space-time phase circulation around the torus. So this sets the stage. Now, I'm going to just write a couple of equations down that might give you some additional insight. So many of you, if not most of you, are familiar with this. This is just a Laguerre-Gaussian beam. This part here is just the transverse phase circulation, right? There's a null at the origin. And this is the standard Gaussian beam stuff, right? The Gaussian radial dependence and then some phase. And you've got the Goy phase and various other things in this piece. So if you want to bring time into the question, you add another coordinate and you define it in these terms. So this is a local space coordinate moving in a frame, moving at the group velocity of the pulse. So you can think of this either as a time-like or space-like variable. If you want to think of this as a space-like variable, then you can think of z as a time-like variable, because z is just the overall propagation distance of the pulse. It's like running a clock, okay? But it's sort of like a time-like variable because you think that, because t is explicitly in this expression. So now you can write this expression. So mathematically, it's very similar to this, except now you can see from this term, you get a spatio-temporal phase circulation. And all the rest of it is almost the same. So you've got the radial fall-off, Gaussian. You've got this new kind of phase term analogous to this, except it's got the C variable in it, and then you've got this extra term. So this means it's pulse-like in time as well. It's Gaussian in time. So that's the structure. Of course, it's not circular like here, so this is an eccentric, because the scales are different on the C variable and on the X variable. But this describes a line vortex. So this describes the line that I showed you in the previous. So that would describe a structure like that. Okay. Okay, so as I said, we're going to consider optical collapse in two systems. The first system is the actually the easiest thing to do because the nonlinear medium is the room air. And room, you know, some people do experiments of with filamentation in xenon, xenon because it has a high nonlinearity, but you don't want to fill your room with xenon. You don't want to use a gas cell. So air is very interesting, and for other reasons air is interesting, as I'll allude to later. Air is mostly molecules. And molecules have other degrees of freedom than electronic, rotational, vibrational. So there's actual effects that are kind of interesting that I'll talk about from that. And then I'll talk about, as I said before, plasmas, optical collapse in plasmas. The nonlinearity in that case is a relativistic nonlinearity, and I'll give you a simple sketch for how that happens. Okay. Okay, so very quick review of filamentation. I know you've had various filamentation folks circulating through the seminar series before. Most of you know that a laser beam diverges, and it diverges because it's a wave. And it's got a natural divergence length, the Rayleigh length, over which the intensity drops by a factor of 2. If you use a lens, things really don't change. You've just changed all the scales in the problem, but again, you're still limited by this. This is the confocal parameter, twice the Rayleigh length. But again, you have some natural scale over which the intensity drops off. Things change when you go nonlinear. So typically, this is an experiment that one can do with a fairly simple laser that is part of a standard ultrafast assistant professor's startup package. Let's say a millijoule at a kilohertz, something like that. It's not cheap, but it's becoming increasingly common. So a few millijoules, 100 femtoseconds. In fact, a millijoule is typically enough. And you get all of a sudden the beam propagates, all of a sudden it collapses, and then there's a high intensity region which propagates quite a long distance. And that distance is quite a bit bigger than the Rayleigh range corresponding to this diameter. Okay, it's not small compared to, or not large compared to a Rayleigh range corresponding to this, but to this small structure here. So the small structure is quite elongated. And then you have, there's supposed to be another arrow here, so it's the full length. So basically the intensity gets very high, and high enough, so it collapses, then it starts ionizing the air, and you get electron densities. This is on the high side. They're more likely 10 to the 16 per cubic centimeter, so that's a fraction of a percent of atmospheric density. So the air is still mostly neutral. It's just a very small amount of ionization, but it's a self-regulating process because only that amount of ionization, a fraction of a percent ionization fraction, is enough to cause the laser beam to refract off the plasma. So it's self-regulating. It doesn't continue to ionize. The intensity can't get that high. The phases are changing. The phase is changing very, very rapidly. You can imagine the nonlinear medium is changing. The polarizability of free electrons is stronger than the polarizability of bound electrons. So as they're contributing to the nonlinear response, you change the phase very rapidly. Because you have a time-varying phase, you get extra frequencies generated. And then you get a white light. So you get this coherent white light beacon ahead of the beam. And this is one of the applications. So there are various things that come out of this. I think I have it on the next slide. Oh, not yet. I'll get to that. So this is what's called a Marou plot, after the guy who made short pulse, what are called chirp pulsed amplification systems popular. So this just runs through the laser history. 1960 lasers invented. The first pulse lasers That was actually a pulse laser. It was really a gain-switched laser. Q-switching came a few years later. I won't get into the details of what all these pulse lasers, how they work and what they do. Mode locking made pulses even shorter. So you have a finite amount of energy. As you make the pulses shorter, you get higher powers. And as you get higher powers, you enter different physics regimes here. So this whole region, until, let's say, the mid-60s, late-60s, was bound electrons. What that meant was you're not ionizing anything. Once you have enough laser power, you start ionizing, and we're in the free electron regime. But again, it's just free electrons responding linearly. You've ionized, and then you're wiggling the free electrons linearly. In 1985, this was invented. This is a technology invented by Gerard Marou and his student Donna Strickland. And you can see this thing shoots up here. And this is the region where we are right now. There's a number of systems in the world that are 10 petawatt. 10 to the 15 is a petawatt. So there are 10 petawatt lasers out there. And where are we in this? So as far as this talk is concerned, let's consider these dashed blue areas. The filaments in air occupy this region right here. This region right here is on the boundary between bound electrons and free electrons. Remember, I said that the fractional ionization in an air filament is a small fraction of a percent, because the free electrons cause the laser they exclude the laser from the volume where high intensity could be. So you actually have a situation where you're propagating, initially propagating a fairly high intensity, but the intensity is clamped at about 10 to the 14 watts per square centimeter, and you have some atoms ionized, some atoms or molecules ionized, and most of them not. This gave rise, and I'm not going to get into this, but there's a very interesting nonlinear optics debate about how do strongly perturbed atoms respond, or atoms and molecules. This is outside the perturbation theory limit. So most nonlinear optics that you're familiar with relies on low-order expansions of polarization in terms of the electric field. You're manifestly not in this region here. You're actually in a region where you're destroying the medium. You're ionizing the medium. So the question is, what is going on? What is the physics inside in the center of this filament, where this very low-density plasma is that's sustaining the filament? So we were involved in that. This was just to say that filaments are interesting physics beyond just this cool thing with the propagation across the room with plasma and white light going forward. The other part of the talk is up here. So you don't have any bound electrons left. You fully ionized the medium. In fact, the medium that we use in our experiments is hydrogen. And hydrogen is pretty easy to ionize, so it's basically protons and electrons. And electrons are happy just to wiggle linearly in the laser field until you get to a high enough laser power, laser intensity, and then the electrons start wiggling nonlinearly. And somebody can stop me with their guess as to why they become linear. It's probably a sophomore or junior physics major undergrad question. Why do you think electrons start responding nonlinearly as you increase the laser intensity? Okay, they're free. Okay, so let's talk about applications. Okay, this is just a very busy graph. If any of you are interested in any of these papers, are very, very a busy plot. So these are applications of filaments. This area down here covers the research in my groups, and naturally I circled it and made it green, and I'm directing your attention to it. But it's also research that led us into this optical vortex stuff as a direct sort of serendipitous result of doing these things. So if you're interested in my slides, there's lots of interesting references. If you're interested in the filamentation field, there's a review that came out now almost 10 years ago, but it's actually pretty good. It starts from the beginning and has lots of interesting references. So I'm going to talk about some of these things here, which led us to do this vortex work. Okay. This is an example of one of the applications of filaments. We have a high-pressure xenon fill in this gas tube, and we send a pulse in from the left, and it generates a filament. And remember, I showed a slide earlier where I said there's a white light beacon, coherent beacon of light that goes forward. Well, there it is, and we use it for a lot of applications. So here's the red line is just the fundamental. That's the original bandwidth of the laser going in. And this is what it is on a linear scale going out. And then we basically subtracted them. So you get this. It's weaker, but it's a huge, huge bandwidth that's out to the UV. And you can use it. And it's coherent across its full bandwidth. And you can use it to do ultra-short pulse diagnostics. And I'll talk about one of them shortly. Okay, so what is the origin of the bound electron nonlinearity? So this is not the this is not the relativistic one. This is simply you have a generic atom. Let's pick the simplest atom available in air at any reasonable density. So it's argon, right? Argon density in air is at roughly 1%. So think of this as an argon atom. So you have a laser field. Okay, there's the atom. You turn on a large laser field. This is an exaggeration. You stretch the atom. The electron cloud basically is driven along the laser field. So and this is, if you're non-resonant, if you're far away from resonances in the atom, which you typically are at visible and infrared wavelengths, the resonances are in the UV, the response is typically instantaneous. That is, there's no lag. The electron cloud basically follows the laser pulse. So we can look at this classically in terms of just a spring model, which is what many of you have studied. You know, before you do quantum mechanics, you imagine the atoms as spring, and you can actually work out the index of refraction as a function of frequency, assuming atoms are a bunch of springs. So basically, by pre-laser eras, I mean pre-1960, pretty much the spring could be considered linear. But after the laser, you started stretching the spring a lot. And you all know that springs, you know, you don't have the harmonic restoring force of a spring once you stretch the spring sort of beyond some limit. And the limit in the case of atoms is when the laser fields get to be some small fraction of the binding field of the electron, that is the Coulomb field. Once it's some, you know, even 1% of the Coulomb field, then the response starts to be nonlinear. So you can think of that as the displacement of the electron cloud starts going like that. And that's enough to give you a nonlinearity. In fact, the second derivative of this thing right here gives you a nonlinear coefficient. That is, the more you stretch the spring, the more floppy the spring gets, the more yielding the electron gets. That's what's called a positive nonlinearity. So as the field goes up, the response actually becomes easier. And as the response becomes easier, that means the index of refraction actually goes up. A more floppy, easily responding medium has a higher index of refraction. Okay, so how do we mathematicize this? So some simple stuff here. We're assuming an instantaneous response. So P, this is the polarization that shows up in Maxwell's equations. You can write it as a power series. So this is perturbation theory here. You can throw away and write it in powers of the applied laser field. Throw that away because of symmetry, because if we flip the field, we want to flip the sign of the polarization. So let's keep the lowest order terms. So this is the linear term, and that's the next order term. And now, if to make it into a P is equal to chi E, we can group terms, and we can write this as an effective chi. Chi is just the boring low-intensity part plus this quadratic part. And the index of refraction is, as you know, and this is Gaussian units, 1 plus 4 pi chi. And then from that, you get the index for small, relatively small fields. So you can see the first correction to the index of refraction is this thing that goes like the intensity or the square of the field. Because the spring gets weaker, N2 is positive. Okay, so that's a positive, that's a typical bound electron nonlinearity. So now, here's the laser radial profile. Many of you know that for a Gaussian laser beam, the phase fronts are pretty flat near the beam waist. That's the narrowest part of the beam. So the phase fronts look like that. The intensity peaks in the center. Now, what does the index profile look like, though? Because you have this dependence, the index profile actually peaks in the center because E squared is bigger in the center. What does a bigger refractive index mean? What does it actually mean? It means the wave moves slower. Larger refractive index means slower moving wave. Therefore, the center of the wave fronts are lagging. They hang back because the index is bigger in the middle. And the outsides, which don't see such a big index, you know, maintain their regular phase velocity. And so you get this focusing, right? This is a picture of focusing when you bend phase fronts like that. So that keeps doing this. And what stops it? What stops it? What happens? It goes to a singularity. In fact, there's a whole field of mathematicians that worry about this thing going to a singularity. But they are mathematicians. What really happens is you do stuff like destroy laser rods or wherever this thing is going on. So you get this collapse. Now, typically, there is a threshold for the collapse. The collapse just doesn't happen unless the collapse, the tendency to self-focus, beats the natural tendency to diffract. Right? A beam is going to want to spread. So before it collapses, you have to overcome that. And that sets up a threshold. So you can calculate relatively easily that there's a power threshold for this collapse to happen. This is the power threshold for the collapse to happen at infinity. That means if you propagate long enough, it'll eventually collapse. Typically, if you want it to collapse in the lab, which is a finite space, 10 meters or less than 10 meters, you got to dial this up higher than that. So this number is typically, for air, about 2 to 10 gigawatts. But it's a lot smaller in solids. Why do you think this is a lot smaller in solids than in a gas for air? What does this depend on? Well, that's just the wavelength. That's the laser you're using. So what's going on here? What's going on here? What about this piece? This is the piece that depends on density. This piece depends on the number of dipoles you have. Okay, right. The thing that's causing the phase front to lag is stretching that spring. Right. Well, the more springs you have, the more action you have on the laser. So this piece here, the N2, is proportional to the density. And this is roughly correct. Right. A solid is 1,000 times less dense than a gas. So you see a factor of 1,000 right there. And again, the first time this was seen in the mid-60s, because people were getting their lasers powerful enough that a laser beam going through an amplifying medium basically generated its own lens and collapsed inside the amplifier medium. So it was a very expensive and unintentional experiment, first done in the mid-60s. Okay, so now let's talk about free electrons. So this is a very simple model, but many of you have seen this. This is just a rate equation for multiphoton ionization with K photons. So because you have to absorb K photons simultaneously, the rate goes like the intensity to the kth power. Okay, there's various other models for ionization. You can actually take the laser electric field as being static and just imagine the electron in the atom is tunneling through its potential barrier and then just becoming free. And the thing driving the tunneling is the laser electric. Any which way, if you drive the intensity high enough, you ionize. Once you generate free electrons, you can still write down an index of refraction, 1 plus 4 pi chi, but the contribution of free electrons to the susceptibility is negative. Free electrons have a negative polarizability. Bound electrons have a positive polarizability. And so you get a negative contribution here, and you can calculate an index of refraction for free electrons. And so let's repeat the same picture that we had before. Here's a laser radial profile. And we're near the beam waist, so the phase fronts are parallel. But this is now a high-order process. This goes like I to the k. And the index increment is negative, so this points the other way, not positive out here. That way, well, what does that do? That is a reduced, you can think of that as a reduced index, and that causes faster propagation. So now the way phase fronts are blowing out the front, and this diverges. So you have these two processes going on simultaneously. They're competing, and that's how the filament generates. So you've got basically a tendency to defocus and a tendency to focus. The defocusing is what arrests the collapse. So basically it's going to go down, it's focusing, and then it will go to a singularity unless something comes in to save the day. What comes in to save the day is the intensity gets high enough that free electrons are generated, and then the phase fronts bulge out, and then it comes out like this. And this is happening all the time. It bulges out, but then it propagates a little farther down here, and then it comes back in again. And what you see in the filament is just those two processes fighting each other. Let me go through this very quickly here, because I can already tell that I'm probably spending a little too much time on some of these details. But molecules are interesting for the following reason. Just look at the top set of pictures here. If you have an electric field, let's say polarized this way, linearly polarized, typically at room temperature, typical sample of air, the molecules are oriented in all random directions, right? This is the molecular axis. But the applied electric field applies a torque to the molecule, right? It induces a dipole first on the along the bond axis, and a little dipole across the bond axis, and the effect of the electric field, right? P cross E is the torque. P cross E is the torque. This is going to cause alignment, like this, and you can measure that alignment. So, what does this mean? Well, what's important here is the ensemble average of the square of the cosine of the angle between the laser polarization and the bond axis. And you can measure this stuff. And to the extent that this thing, which is a solid angle average of 1/3 when they're all randomly oriented, differs from a third, you get an index change. And this is the kind of thing we can measure. Now, why is that important? It's important because there's a delayed index. So these are pictures using the, again, this is a little complicated. Maybe I shouldn't include this. It's too much into the nitty-gritty. But I just like showing it because it's sort of cool. This is experimental data. So this is space, and this is time. So think of it as we had a bunch of nitrogen molecules originally randomly oriented, and then we came in with a very short pulse. What happens initially is you distort the electron clouds around all the nitrogen molecules, and you get an instantaneous response. That is the result of the electrons jumping on all of the randomly oriented molecules. The electron clouds just getting quickly pushed. Then what happens is the molecules, because they have inertia, take time. They rotate into the direction of the laser polarization. You get a delayed response, which shows up here 100 femtoseconds later, and that's this. So we're mapping out the full nonlinearity. And both of these pieces actually contribute as a beam propagates in air. You get this prompt thing because of all the random orientations, but you also get a delayed rotational effect. And that shows up in this vortex discussion. And this is just lineouts. And you can run with a probe pulse perpendicular or parallel to the pump. But just think of this as a 1D plus time picture of the molecular response in nitrogen. Okay, so I kind of showed you that. So the second hump is rotation. The first is basically the electronic. Okay, so I'm now getting to the vortex stuff. So what led us to that was first considering what happens when filaments propagate through the air. Well, after they propagate through the air, they leave energy deposited, right? So I showed that filaments can make plasma. That plasma is hot, and that plasma basically recombines and thermalizes and heats the air locally. But it does something else, too. It causes a rotational excitation. Because you're torquing all these molecules, you're basically you're pumping a bunch of rotational states, and you're shifting the rotational populations, and that has to cool down. So some tens of nanoseconds after that happens, the temperature in the region where the filament used to be is elevated. Okay? It's like a line. It's like a thermal line source. A filament is long gone, but this thermal line source, as far as the air is concerned, is like a delta function, right? It's still all these things I'm telling you are really, really fast. We can measure them all and resolve them in time, but air is just sitting there going, "What's going on?" Boom! It gets slapped in the face. Everything dies down, but the temperature. You know, everything dies down as far as these fast processes, but what's left here is a temperature, an elevated temperature region in the center. This basically causes a fast sound wave to be emitted from this region. Now, this is, by fast sound wave, I mean a single cycle sound wave. The sound speed is the sound speed. It's not any faster than the sound speed. This is the equivalent pressure, basically, which you can calculate from all the energy deposition mechanisms. So we did some measurements, and this shows experiments and simulations which agree quite nicely. So this is end-on of a filament. So the filament has long left the building, or left the experimental region, and this dark region is a single-cycle sound wave, which just leaves the region of the filament. It just propagates out. It's not multiple-cycle sound wave, right? Because it's responding to a delta function. It's not like you have a oscillator, you know, or a speaker repeatedly driving the air, or your vocal cords repeatedly driving the air. It's a delta function applied to the air, so you get a single-cycle sound wave leaving. And then what's left, microseconds later, is a hole in the density. And this is what we're interested in. We're interested in all parts of this, but this is what we're most interested in for application. So this actually can last milliseconds. The application of this is this air waveguiding experiment that we did a couple of years ago. So the idea was this. If we send in a TEM11 mode, and you get a filamentary collapse of this thing, then you get four filaments. And long after the filaments have left, you get four holes. Can you use these four holes? So this is the setup. I won't get into the details of this. The whole point is we used a pretty cheap way to make the TEM11. We had a couple of pellicles we cut with a razor blade and angled them. So that gave us four segments that were pi out of phase with respect to each segment was pi out of phase with respect to the adjacent segment. So that's how we made this. So we made four filaments. And again, if you're interested in this, I don't want to spend a lot of time, but this is the guiding experiment. The idea was you made four density holes thermally diffused into each other, so that made if I go back to the previous slide, once you make four density holes here, the center is the unperturbed density of the air. There's a density hole where each of these is, and then they thermally diffuse. So in the end, you get something that looks like a core and a cladding. The cladding is the lower density. The lower index region is the cladding. The center is the core. And that thing acts like an air waveguide. And we've done this since then with eight lobes as well. So this thing works pretty well. Here's the data from the guiding experiment. Again, you can read about it here if you're interested. But let me just go through that. So now what led us to this vortex business is this. We were always wondering, after filamentary collapse, those four beams in the TEM11 mode, they still stayed in phase. Right? Remember, they're originally 0 pi, 0 pi, 0 pi. No, whatever it is. They're pi apart. The adjacent ones are pi apart. And I said also, right, when you make the filament, these things are undergoing massive phase shifts because you're strongly nonlinearly perturbing the medium, and you're generating the supercontinuum light. How come, here, this is after 5 meters away, four white light spots, all apparently still pi phase shifted. So pi phase shift here, pi phase shift here, pi phase shift here, here. This thing stays like this. It doesn't combine in any way. It stays coherent. So the question is, what's going on with the phase here? So again, this is a separate funded project, so we're sending these TEM11 modes down a long hallway. You can actually see it's sort of starting to work. Our laser broke, but we're almost guiding these beams. You know, you can see the location of these thermal imprints. Anyway, then we got diverted. What's with this thing? Why do these things stay in phase? So, well, we had to invent a new kind of experiment, a new diagnostic. What do we want to know? We want to know the intensity profile in the middle of a filament and the phase in the middle of a filament. Well, what's the problem with doing that? In the middle of the filament, the intensity is 10 to the 14 watts per square centimeter. So it's not like you can take a lens on axis and image what's going on, right? Because you'll drill the lens. Or you could say, well, let me put the lens far away after the filament is stopped, and then just image back to some location inside. You can't do that either because you have nonlinear optics going on in there. You can only do imaging when you have linear optics, right? You can't, you know, there's still some nonlinear. So what you have to do is somehow image inside the filament. So what we did was this. We arranged for an interface between air and helium. So air is coming, so the filament is coming from all the way over here. And then we arranged for the air to stop and helium to begin. I haven't told you how we do it yet. And I'll rely on the fact that the nonlinearity of air is over 20 times higher than the nonlinearity of helium. The nonlinearity in helium is actually rather small. Why do you think that is? Test question. Why? Not density. So just think of an atom. A typical atom of helium has a much smaller nonlinearity than a typical atom, than an argon atom, let's say. What's the thing about helium? Got one s2 electrons, right? It's just, and what do we know about those core electrons of helium? They're incredibly strongly bound. So the spring constant is massive, if you want to think about a helium atom in terms of spring. So the spring, the binding of those core electrons in helium is really, really strong. So what that means is you can't stretch the spring, you can't stress the spring too much, so the nonlinear is rather small. So basically, if you have a filament coming along this way, and then it hits this interface, it stops being nonlinear, and then there's linear propagation thereafter. That then allows you to set up optics downstream and linearly image this interface. Okay, so how do we do that? You thought I wouldn't show you something complicated like this, so don't focus on this whole thing, just focus on this. We have a helium cell, and we pressurize it a little above atmospheric pressure so that there's a slow, gentle flow out of this nozzle. So there's actually a helium source that's filling up this cell, and there's a laminar flow, not just very gentle, that goes out this way, and there's a transition of 3 millimeters or so between helium and air. And how did we measure that? We just had a tightly focused beam, and we broke down the helium or broke down the air, and we just looked at the spectra. And we saw when the helium lines appeared and disappeared, and so we could just map out. We see oxygen and helium. So as the helium dies, the oxygen starts up. So this is the interface. Because the filament is so long, the filament here is about 2 meters long, the 3 millimeter transition is essentially like an interface. And we verified this with simulations. So that works fine. So the thing to understand here, or to take away from this picture, is that we collect a huge amount of data. So we move this thing all along the filament. The filament basically starts shortly after this last mirror. And we go all the way along a 2 millimeter filament, two meter filament. And then we look at a huge range of energies, so many, many laser energies. And we scan a wave plate between 0 and 5 millijoules at each position. So we actually have this huge space of Z position and P over P crit. Remember, P crit is this special number which gives the threshold for self-focusing collapse. So that's what we have for air. The idea for the helium cell came from the NRL people, Tony Ting, which they used it for a different purpose, but we repurposed it for this experiment. Okay, so here's an example of the kind of data we collect. So we parked that cell at a particular position, okay, and the scale is important. It was, on our scale, it was 150 centimeters. And we started with zero laser energy, and then we started increasing it. So ignore the scatter and the points. This is actually an interferometric measurement, and you know, we didn't have the best stability, so that's what this scatter is all about. The red dots are averages along this axis of the scattered blue points. But what happens is the phase front, this is at the beam center, in the middle of the beam, the phase starts going up, 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 up. So why does the phase initially increase? I showed you, right? Bound electrons. Bound electrons means self-focusing. As you have self-focusing, the phase front curvature gets larger. So that's what this is. The phase front curvature is getting. We can measure the phase front curvature because we're doing interferometry across the face of the beam. And then it stops. And then just a little more at this, around P over P crit is 5, it flips actually by 2 pi and then starts going up, goes like this. So there's a 2 pi phase jump here. Now this, you can't, now you could say, well, 2 pi is the same as 0. Is this some phase error in your extraction? No, because it's an interferogram, and we can see the lines of in the interferogram smoothly moving across a 2 pi phase shift. So it's a smooth transition. It's not some phase extraction error from our interferogram. So it's a smooth 2 pi shift in our interferogram. So we're identifying this here as collapse arrest, right? Because when you get a negative phase shift, the only thing that could cause it is a plasma, right? It's a negative susceptibility. So we do some modeling. So that was intriguing. Now this appeals to the people who do propagation simulations. So here's our model. Our model is basically the nonlinear Schrodinger equation with some complicated physics. All the complicated physics are in here, including the standard terms. I won't get into this, but this is diffraction. This is just the propagation term. This is dispersion, beta is the GVD, and we do this in local space coordinates. V has got two contributions, as I've gone through, sort of with simple models, the bound electron contribution and the free electron contribution. And so here are the various terms. This is the standard Kerr term. So this is the term that goes N to E squared. The psi here is just the field amplitude. So this is the Kerr term. This is the term. This is why I sort of dragged you through this molecular response business. This is a delayed term, which basically takes into account the history of the molecule as it rotates up to the present time t from way back in time minus infinity. Okay, so this is the delayed molecular rotation. This is mostly focusing, mostly positive. This thing can go actually negative because the molecules sometimes pass through a perpendicular orientation with respect to the laser field. And when they're perpendicular to the laser field, they're actually contributing less than the average. When they're all average orientation, there's a net small positive contribution. But when they're perpendicular, the contribution is actually less than that. So the net contribution is negative. But it's small intervals in time. This is a timing question. And then ionization. This is trivial, right? Integral of d by dt versus t. It's not trivial. Just insert your favorite ionization model here. That's what that means. There's lots of different models. This represents some dynamical model for ionization. You can just stick it in there. And so this is the free electron response. So that's all in this model. Okay, why did I show you all that? Because this is the result of the simulation. The way this all happened was we were at a standstill in the experiment. We just decided to stare at our simulations for a while. So this is the stuff that we saw. And I'm going to explain this just hopefully clearly. Again, this is all in the moving reference frame. These two panels are the laser intensity. This here is a quarter section of the phase. So it's a cylindrically symmetric picture. So you could take this, build one up here, identical, over on the top, identical, and on the bottom. So just multiply this by 4. So this really here is a circle going around. And if you look at the phase, you can actually see these phase circulations. So this is 2 pi phase circulation, and it's a torus actually going all the way around. There's another one here, and there's another one here. The way they're generated, and you just see this, you build up intuition. Sometimes things are so complicated, you have to build up intuition by looking at simulations. Later you can do an analytic theory, but sometimes, you know, this is just how it happens in physics. You do a lot of simulations, and you can't necessarily do everything in an experiment and build up intuition that way. So that's how we did it. We did simulate, build up intuition. So what happens here is that there's two places where the nonlinearity between the center, the difference in nonlinearity between the center of the beam and the outside of the beam gets so strong that these vortices are generated. And again, I'll tell you how in a minute, but I'm just saying now they are generated. One is near the front of the pulse envelope where the peak Kerr nonlinearity is the highest. And then there's much later, and it's when 100 femtoseconds later when the molecules decide to line up. They take time to line up. And what happens is you get two vortices generated early in time, and they spread apart. So this one stays more or less with the pulse. This moves back in time. There's two more generated. One has left the building, but one has actually moved forward in time, and it's about to annihilate with that guy. So this is, you see one circulates one way, one circulates the other way. And you can see this in the simulation I'm going to show you next. Okay, this is pointing the other way. I don't know why I could have had it point the same way. So it's making demands on you that I shouldn't have to make. But now this is pointing the other way. No doubt you've had lecturers do this to you too. Okay, let this start up again. Okay, let's go through it. But this is the phase evolution. Okay, I hope it starts again. I don't have to push the button. Anyway, this is annihilation about to happen here. This is a phase vortex that's propagating with the pulse. Yeah, annihilation just happened. Okay, now I got to push this again. Oop, let me go back. All right, so the thing's propagating. I'll tell you when to look here. Okay, right there. That's the vortex that's moving forward in time. That's moving back in time. They're about to annihilate, and there's another one forming right there. So there's phase, 2 pi phase circulation, minus 2 pi and plus 2 pi. They're going to cancel. They're going to cancel right there. And this just propagates with the pulse. Notice, I'm going to go back to the previous slide, where the vortex appears. So here's the leading vortex that propagates with the pulse. There's actually a region of low intensity in here. And this is sort of what I was trying to depict in that very first slide that showed that chunk eaten out of that red pulse with the toroid in it. This is sort of what I'm talking about. And there's other ones that are generated here. So these two are about to annihilate right here. Okay. Now, why does this all happen? Because I haven't explained any of that yet. So the way you can think about this, that's very, very useful in terms of this toy model. Okay, so this, so many of you recognize this as being the nonlinear phase shift due to the Kerr response, right? So remember I said that the index change went like N2 times E squared? So therefore, the accumulated propagation phase is just the K times that delta N, that index perturbation, times the propagation distance. So the nonlinear phase is actually accumulated as propagation happens along Z, okay? Very simple. And this is in the frame of the pulse. Remember, I'm using this favorite variable here. This is the position vector, this is the position variable in the moving frame of the pulse. Okay, so now what kind of pulse am I talking about here? It's pulse, this is the pulse in time, so it's Gaussian, but it's a half-plane wave. So it's got most of its intensity up here, and it's got a little bit of density down here. So I shouldn't say no phase shift, I should say itty-bitty phase shift down here. Very little intensity. So this expression is much bigger here than down here. In fact, it's small enough that down here, there's very little nonlinear phase shift. So these are the initial phase fronts. So down here, it's not changing. Up here, it's changing. Again, this is a half a plane wave. So up here, all of this is high intensity. This is low intensity. And there's just a sharp step here. Is this real? No, because a sharp step is going to diffract. But I don't care. It's a toy model, and it's just here to illustrate the effect. So now as this thing propagates, you pick up red shift on the front of the pulse. You can see the red shift because the phase fronts are farther apart. And the blue shift on the back of the pulse. The phase fronts are closer together, right? Lower frequencies, bigger spacing between phase fronts. And again, down here, there's low intensity, not much happening. If you propagate far enough, how far? This magic distance here, right? You just plug this into this expression, and you pick up a phase shift of pi. What happens at pi? You get a field null right there. This is what's called an edge dislocation. And they took this from solid state physics, from atomic planes. But this was first written about in this famous paper from 1974 by Barry and Nye. And so you have an envelope null right at that point. If you propagate a little farther, you see a phase circulation of minus pi and a phase circulation of pi. In other words, this thing splits into two vortices. Now, this is seemingly trivial. In fact, the way I presented this, it's almost kinematic, right? You just go along, and then this thing happens, and this thing happens. But it's not kinematic. There's physics here. The physics is the nonlinearity that gives rise to this phase shift in the first place, right? So there is physics here. But these are then robust. These have topological charge plus one, minus one, and then this thing. So this is what's happening in the simulation, and then as I'll show you in the experiment. So now let's look at more dimensions, a more realistic picture. So here's the beam. The beam is propagating this way. It starts to collapse, right? The phase fronts get more and more curved because the bound electrons are responding nonlinearly. The self-collapse. So the center gets more and more peaked. And then what happens is you start generating some free electrons in the center. Then you start radically changing the phase shift between the center and the outside. Then you pick up that pi phase shift that I showed in the earlier slide. When that happens, you're nulling out the field. So the field actually drops off somewhere outside. Now, what's important about collapse arrest is that it stabilizes the location where this phase shift can accumulate. If you didn't have that, this boundary, this knee would shift around radially, and there wouldn't be a nice location for this phase shift to happen. You have to have enough stability, so in propagation you pick up this phase shift, and then this happens. So this is where the null happens, and then as we saw in the toy model, that will give rise to vortices. So here's a picture. This is more simulation. So what this says, what we're doing here is we're riding with the pulse, and we're picking a special plane. So this is a plane in the moving frame of the pulse. We know where the vortex is going to happen later, right? We've already done the simulation. We know where it's happening because we looked at the code output. And then we said, let's follow this special plane from the very beginning, right? And so we're following that plane. This is phase, and this is intensity. So let's look at intensity first. This is the log of the intensity. So this is just a Gaussian beam initially. It's just propagating. As you start picking up the nonlinear phase of the bound electrons in the center, it starts to peak up. Eventually, you start arresting the collapse, and you start picking up this null. And you have a little dip in the middle because the plasma electrons start to refract the beam. So you get a little dip. And look here, just a little distance later, 1 centimeter later in the propagation, you drop the null location in amplitude by a couple of orders of magnitude. So this field null gets very, very small. In fact, we're limited by the numerical precision of the simulation here. In fact, analytically, this goes literally to zero. So we could follow this down as far as we wanted and increase the expense of the simulation. And you see what happens here in the phase is that when this happens here, you get this region of flat phase in the core. And it flips sign here. It flips basically by 2 pi. You can see from minus 1 to plus 5, which is about 6, which is about 2 pi. And now, because the vortex, remember, we're following this special plane, CV, but now once the vortex is born, it migrates according to its own velocity. It has a life of its own. We derive the equations of motion for the vortex in our PRX paper. If you're interested, you can look at them. But now it's out of focus. The vortex moved from this plane CV. But this is the birth right here. Now let's talk about the experiment. Here's the experiment. So we parked at a special location, P, it's not a special location, a typical location, a location where P is P crit is 4.4. The early one was 5, but again, we have such a dense collection of data, we could have looked anywhere. So we just looked here in the data, and so you see what's happening here is so phase intensity, as the propagation, so this is at one spatial location at 4.4. So we have several conditions here. Remember, because we're jumping across that collapse point, we can get phases jumping from 2 pi or from pi to minus pi and vice versa. So you can actually see this here. The core phase is going from pi here to minus pi. This is not exact absolute phase, it's just relative phase, but the jump is about 2 pi from here to here. And this is the intensity, so we get this ring null. So this is the place where the field drops essentially to zero. So this is pretty much what it looks like in the simulations. This is simply a picture that shows that the phase transition between the center and the outside is smooth. Okay, so it's not an error in the phase extraction. Now, these structures are not just mathematical curiosities. There's actually energy flow surrounding them. So in air, because the density is low, so look, first of all, this is an expression that we derive in the paper. You can think of it as the pointing flux in the vicinity of one of these vortices. So this is unsurprising, right? The gradient of the electromagnetic phase typically gives you the direction of energy flux. But we have another term because this is taken in the spatio-temporal plane. So this is a term that's a gradient in that local space variable in the pulse propagation frame. And it has a coefficient of the GVD. So the GVD is very important in determining the energy flow. In air, it doesn't matter. We call that the degenerate case because the density of air is so low that beta is small. So this term is really small. And what we're getting here is pretty much the gradient of the phase. And this is what it looks like. So the center of the beam is right here. And this is outside. So the center of the beam is here. The vortex is on the outside. And what's happening here is energy is getting sucked in by the positive nonlinearity. Right? This is the self-focusing part. Ionization happens, and then energy is expelled from the center of the beam. So this whole thing is mediated by a vortex. In fact, this plane here is where we're seeing the flat phase. So when we jump from here to here, this is the 2 pi phase jump. From here to here. So that's what we were measuring, that flat phase inside the ring. The ring is here, the center of the beam is here, and this is basically the flat phase region. If you go to a condensed medium with negative GVD, and we're doing this now with mid-IR and glass, the pointing flux is circular. It goes like this. So the pulse is propagating, and you get electromagnetic flow circulating around the vortex. In a positive GVD medium, so I say plasma here. This is a dense plasma. GVD in plasma is negative, but this would apply to a negative GVD solid density medium also. A solid density medium here with positive GVD, the saddle, energy flow is a saddle shape. So we're doing experiments just measuring all these things right now. Okay, so basically, if you wanted to visualize filamentation in a very, very simple way, you can do this. You can think of it as this optical object. This is sort of reminiscent of the very first slide I showed. So there was this pulse with sides eaten out of it, and then this toroidal ring. You can think of it as this way. This thing is controlling the global energy flow. It's mediating the energy exchange between the front of the pulse, which has got energy flowing in due to self-focusing, and the back of the pulse, which has energy flowing out due to refraction. This is sort of, if you want it, the filaments are very complicated objects. When I was explaining it earlier, I said, well, you got self-focusing and then defocusing, and they're talking to each other, and they're sort of interplaying. Well, there it is. You can think of it just as this. And this, we think of this, this is a unified picture of what's going on, and this vortex ties it all together. This is now robust. This could also be considered, and I'll show you this shortly, considered it as a fundamental reason why filaments like to propagate so robustly over long distances.
Isn't that sort of the nonlinear spatial replenishment, essentially? In the sense that the plasma, you get a hole.
Okay, let me supplement that by saying, in the filament community, there's always been a discussion about the core and the reservoir. I don't know if that paper you used those. So the core is actually the inside of the vortex, and the reservoir is outside of the vortex.
Essentially what happens is like you get a hole in the center. The plasma creates a hole, essentially, and then it sort of evacuates. And then it could refocus again subsequently. That looks reminiscent of...
Right. But in the spatial replenishment model, there's not a definite length scale established.
No, we never looked at the phase or anything.
Yeah. And this basically establishes a radial length scale, which if you mess with it, you're going to have consequences. And I'll show this. Okay. No one put their hand up about the relativistic nonlinearity. But you probably, basically, at low, so this is relativistic self-focusing. At low field, you wiggle a free electron, and the free electron velocity is, you may know, is pi by 2 out of phase with the driver. That's just because the acceleration is pi by 2 out of phase with the velocity, basically. And so this is what you have. At high field, it's just trivially the fact that you can't drive the electron faster than c, right? So its orbits are going to be basically truncated near their tips somewhere, right? That thing already has harmonics. Right there. That object has harmonics. So you can basically show, very simply, that the effective index of a relativistically driven free electron plasma is n0 plus n2 times the square of the electric field. And you can also show that this thing scales like 1 over the fourth power of the frequency, which is very exciting for those of us getting involved in long wavelength laser research. So I know I'm together with Miro and Jerry on two MURIs now that are looking at physics of long wavelength interactions, and this is one of the things we're going to be doing. What this means is relativistic nonlinearities are way more accessible at long wavelengths than they are at optical and near infrared wavelengths. Okay, let me just quickly jump through this. I'm actually making half decent time. Is this supposed to end at 4:45 or 5?
Question at 5.
4:45? Okay, let me quickly jump through this. Basically, this is the whole game of laser acceleration. Basically, you focus a laser beam in a plasma, and now what happens here is the intensity, it relativistic self-focuses, the way it arrests is that you push electrons out of the way. The electrons don't cause defocusing. What happens is because it's all electrons to begin with. So the thing that stops the collapse is that the light pressure pushes the electrons out of the way, and then you have no more nonlinear medium to keep the self-focusing going. So electrons are pushed out of the way. That sets up a field for acceleration, and the field is pointing along the laser axis. So it's actually an electrostatic field. These are plasma wave oscillations, and that's what causes the acceleration. So that's something we do in my lab. And let me just skip to the main point that's relevant for this talk. So these are 3D particle and cell simulations. We can no longer do simple wave propagation simulations because the medium is getting pushed around by light pressure. What these are is you're actually every time step solving Maxwell's equations, then you're pushing the electrons and ions around, then you're resolving Maxwell's equations, pushing the ions and electrons around, okay? Because the Maxwell's equations depend on source terms, right? Depends on density and current, charge density and current density. So you push every time you push after a time step, push charge around. You're changing the current density and the charge density. Then you can reevaluate Maxwell's equation. So that's what this does. The laser pulses here, these are actually peaks in the plasma density that follow the laser pulse. This is actually an accelerated electron beam. That's what happens in our lab. So basically, you get the same kind of thing. And the question is, what happens? This is a little more propagation, and you're tightening up the phase fronts. The thing I wanted to point out is you generate stoves. So this is, again, a edge dislocation in the phase fronts, and you get 2 pi phase circulation, and at that location, the field drops. There's a null right there. You get these stoves. Here it is. We blew it up. You get a stove. You can see there's a continuous 2 pi phase shift from one fringe to the next. This is the same cartoon I had before, just to remind you, but there's no time left. Let me keep going. This is where the null happens. This is not just a trivial thing. There's actually 40% of the laser energy on the outside of these things. That's the same thing in air filamentation. I should have mentioned that. These are not just hanging out on the outside as spectators. There's a lot of laser energy radially on the outside of those things. This is a saturated color map just to show these things developing. Here they are. One's going backwards. One's going forwards. Then the other one is gone. And here it is. Here's 2. And this just guides the pulse. There's the 2 pi phase shift. Pointing flux. Okay. This is a 3D simulation. So these stoves actually don't form as rings like I showed in the early simulations. They're phase defects. There they go as a function. These are field nulls. These are the stoves. Eventually, though, a ring forms. So this actually propagates with the pulse with a relativistic self-focused laser pulse. Okay, robustness of stoves. I promised to get to this. So here is what we did is a 3D PIC simulation. We set up a region of density here that's really high. And here's a relativistic filament propagating. Here's the stove. The stove location is here. So this is the cross-section. This is the edges of a toroidal ring. It's a torus going in and out of the board. We put this here. We block it. And kablooey. It just destroys the propagation. Now what we did was put it just inside the stove. Well, the beam reforms beyond. So this thing, you can think of it as it's like a switchyard for electromagnetic energy flow. And it's robust because it has topological charge. Just because you block it in the middle, yeah, that's going to be disruptive. But this whole flow field is still there. And that's what reforms the pulse. So this is actually a 3D PIC code. It's as close to an experiment as you can get. And we believe that this is, and we're doing experiments right now, this is basically what happens in air for closing apertures down on filaments. So let me conclude, because time is getting short. I don't want to get into all these details except to say, to focus on this, that we think any self-guiding process, whether it's in air or in plasmas or filamentation process, is really the same as stoves. These are essential features of the process, and in fact, we think it's more than chicken and egg. We think they're actually guiding the process and dominating the physics of the process once they appear. Thank you.